And this evening with Henry Schacht. He is the chairman of Lucent Technologies, a company that has been in some trouble, but is at the heart of the technological revolution.
Starts in the 1996 Telecommunications Restructuring Act, which unleashed marvelous new talents, unleashed marvelous new technologies, but it also created a sense of euphoria financed both by Wall Street, by the West Coast financiers, and by companies like ours. And it got beyond its capacity to be sustained. And when that happens, you go through a period of very difficult retrenchment, in which we're in the middle of. And it's very painful, and there's no other way out of it, because if you don't do the right things, then there won't be a surviving company. That doesn't help anyone.
Also joining us this evening, the distinguished historian, Stephen Ambrose.
Listen, I was 10 years old when the war ended.
Right.
I always looked on those guys as giants, my father among them.
Right.
And they were. And I still feel that way. I'm a hero worshiper, and these guys were our heroes. How did these guys do it? That's what I wanted to know.
We conclude with NBA superstar Stephon Marbury.
I'm delighted. I'm elated. I'm so happy about the trade. Because, one, I feel like God puts everyone in place where he wants them to be. And also, I feel like this is the closest that I'm going to be as far as to win an NBA championship. I'm older now. I'm more responsible now, and I see things totally different.
A look ahead at the world of Lucent Technologies and the new technology. A look back at the history of World War II and the brave young men who flew bomber missions over Germany. And a revisit from NBA superstar Stephon Marbury coming up.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Lexus is a proud corporate sponsor of public television.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Henry Schacht is chairman and CEO of Lucent Technologies, the largest manufacturer of telecom equipment. He came out of retirement and returned to Lucent in October of 2000 to help the company execute a turnaround. Since then, he has implemented a radical restructuring of the company, laying off tens of thousands of employees, reorganizing business units, restoring credit, and selling assets. After failed merger talks this spring with Alcatel, Schacht has said that Lucent will remain independent and has vowed to return the company to profitability by the end of next year. I am pleased to have him back at this table. The last time I was here, we were talking about his return to Lucent, where he came back after one of, I think, a protege, Rich McGinn was a protege of yours,
right,
had come there. And then, why did you come back, just to review that one more time?
This time?
No,
Well, my wife, my marvelous wife, had the best line I've heard yet, and the most appropriate one. She said, you had the opportunity to help start Lucent, you have the responsibility to help fix it.
So it was responsibility.
Yes,
you felt like and especially because your guy was leaving, you had to come in and pick up.
Not had to, but it was the right thing to do.
You felt the duty and the sense of responsibility to stockholders, to everybody,
Lucent.
To Lucent.
Everybody connected with Lucent. It's publics, it's customers, it's employees, most of all, that I knew well. And the responsibility was there, and here I am.
You are not the only CEO who's having to lay off employees. John Chamber, in the conversation with me, was close to tears talking about what he's had to do at Cisco. Because he swore he would never do it after his experience at Wang.
Yeah.
Tell me about that, what it does, and how you go about it, and what are the values you have to keep in front of you?
I'll tell you, any time it doesn't bother you and bring you close to tears, you're in deep trouble. Start there. The most difficult decision any company has to make, and any chief executive has to make, is to reduce the size of the company. And to reduce the size of the company substantially to where you say to very good people who've spent a lot of time doing very good work, I'm sorry, we don't have enough work to go around.
It's not your fault.
And it's not your fault, and I'm staying and you're leaving. toughest thing anybody has to do. And any time it isn't tough, you ought to get out of the business.
And then tell me what you owe those people.
You owe those people...
Other than honesty.
Well, what you... To start with, what you... The fundamental responsibility of any chief executive is for the health of the company. And we all know that. And when you get in a position where you have expanded beyond your capacity to provide the employment, then you owe it to the people who are going to remain and the company that has a capacity to rebuild itself to make the decision first in what's best interest of the company, as difficult as that may be, and then to say to those for whom you no longer have work, look, we will treat you as fairly and honestly and as humanely and as responsibly as we possibly can. In our case, It's hard to believe the numbers, but we are in the process of reducing a further 15,000 to 20,000, having already reduced by 20,000.
So this is, you're talking about at least 35, maybe 40.
That's right, 40,000.
Which is one of the largest corporate reductions, layoffs ever.
That's right, and you're talking about human beings, you're talking about their families, you're talking about the investments they've made in the company with full expectation that if they performed, there would be work for them, and there isn't.
Why did it come to this?
I think everybody is wondering that question, but the unsimple answer is that we, as an entire industry, expanded beyond our capacity to a place where we no longer had the capacity to sustain the growth we expected. Each of us expected, I think, to get growth at the expense of the other, and when you edit it all up, it was not sustainable. It starts in the 1996 Telecommunications Restructuring Act, which unleashed marvelous new talents, unleashed marvelous new technologies, but it also created a sense of euphoria financed both by Wall Street, by the West Coast financiers, and by companies like ours. And it got beyond its capacity to be sustained. And when that happens, you go through a period of very difficult retrenchment, in which we're in the middle of. Mm-hmm. And it's very painful, and there's no other way out of it, because if you don't do the right things, yeah, then there won't be a surviving company. That doesn't help anybody.
I want to get to that. I mean, you have said before, and in interviews I've seen, in which you've said, look, this is not effectively, you basically said, there are no new ideas. We know what we have to do.
Absolutely.
You know, we've got to lay off. We've got to get tough. We've got to reduce our expenses. And we've got to go back to the things that we know how to do.
Right.
Right?
Absolutely. There is no magic. That in a position like this, you have to resist the temptation to look for a silver bullet. There isn't one. If there would have been a silver bullet, you know, people would have used it.
There's
long
no new
ago.
Technology is going to save.
No, nothing's. What you have to get over is that somehow the market or a new technology or some sudden thought will get you through a period like we are now in. This is hard work, back to basics, unpleasant as all get out for many of the people involved, but a chance to rebuild a great company, and others are doing the same thing.
Okay, but let me talk about that a little bit. There was a notion that you and others, but Lucent, made a bet that was not appropriate, in a sense, betting on a demand that perhaps Lucent should have been smarter about.
Well, it's hindsight, as I said to everybody, hindsight is marvelous, and I can remember the debate we had within the company about whether a company that had grown from $18 billion to 35, approaching 40, continue to grow at 20% a year, 25% a year, and saying to ourselves, can you really add another $10 billion in this upcoming year? And getting ourselves convinced it was worth one more round. Hmm. And it's that one more round issue, and our competition does the same thing, and the new entrants do the same thing, and all of a sudden it just isn't there. And we overshoot. And we overshoot by quite a bit, it turns out. And when that happens, then modest, you know, easing of the accelerator, modest application of the brake doesn't work. You have to stop, say, okay, what is it that we can now think about in terms of demand over the next couple of years? And we must reposition the company in order to take advantage of the demand that is likely to be there, not the demand that we hope will be there.
Okay, and that will produce a kind of growth rate at what level?
Everybody's got their own view. Nobody knows how long this is going to last, and particularly in terms of the lenses of the technology people, quite separate from the rest of the economy. I think people who look at technology and say, therefore, the U.S. economy, are making a linkage that isn't necessarily as close as some seem to think it is. I think those looking through the technology lens are looking at a particular set of circumstances, and we have to deal with it. which is demand got way beyond itself. We put too much, we put capacity in place that will take some time to absorb.
Right.
We will have to live on less demand for a period of time, certainly the rest of this year, probably next year. I would say by 2003 we should be back into the 10-12% range.
Yeah. But are you selling off things now? I'm thinking in terms of fiber optics and those kinds
sure.
of things. Opticals and that kind of whole sense of it. Everybody knows that's going to be the future. They just don't know when the demand is coming. No, am I right or not?
No, so that's a different issue. We made the decision last fall when we put this team together to concentrate solely on the large service providers worldwide. We then took an inventory of the kinds of products we are producing that over the next 3 to 4 years would differentiate ourselves in the eyes of this particular customer set. And we can
talk about people like Verizon, people like that.
Yes, Verizon,
right.
Bell South, SBC,
sure.
Quest, Sprint, AT&T, this kind of folk worldwide, BT, FT.
The people who can place big orders.
The large, complex companies who have the most complex networks that we know best. And we said, what in those networks are likely to differentiate us in their eyes? And enterprise equipment was not one of them, so Avaya was spun off. Semiconductors were not one of them. Very good businesses, both. They're being spun off.
Yeah.
Fiber, super business, but that's being spun off. Those are businesses from which we want to recover our investment of assets and then redeploy those assets in the very narrow sense of a somewhat smaller, more focused Lucent to serve the service providers. These are very good businesses.
That's my point. I was getting to that point.
Very good businesses.
It's not you're saying we no longer believe in the future of
Absolutely
these businesses.
Absolutely not.
These are businesses
these
that
are
simply
first-rate businesses
are not a priority for us because we got a higher mandate.
No, we have a different mandate.
Different.
It's not any better or any worse. It's just different.
I don't mean better value, but better in terms of what you have been doing that you know best.
The customer, the major service providers worldwide that we have elected to major on, to focus on, have a set of requirements that we believe we understand very well. And we are narrowing our focus and our reach to really depend on our ability to differentiate ourselves in their eyes. Mm-hmm. And these other things are very good businesses, but in our view, won't differentiate ourselves in the eyes of this particular customer set.
Okay, but does anything that makes you think, well, I'm not going to be on the cutting edge of where the future is at all?
Quite the contrary. Bell Labs is at the heart. This
right.
is the heart and soul of the place. It remains the heart and soul of our innovation engine.
There was a time when you said, when you thought of technology, you thought of Bell Labs.
I think you still do. I think you still do.
When you thought of the future of telecom technology,
I think
of Bell Labs.
I think you still do. The heart and soul of Lucent has been its technological capacity to innovate. And that is what we are all about. And we have narrowed the focus, but not the intensity.
Okay.
If anything, we've increased the intensity, but on a much narrower scale.
Increasing the intensity means what?
That means really focusing energy on a much narrower, same amount of energy in a narrow space, which increases the intensity.
Okay. Understanding you have to do what's best for Lucent and your stockholders, and that's what you're trying to do. Tell me what you think this world of telecommunications is becoming. You know, you're going to be there to serve the big providers like mm-hmm. Verizon and all those people, Bell South. And you can do a full service servicing of them, I
yes.
assume.
It's solution, software, hardware,
right.
services.
You come in and we'll do the whole thing. We'll do.
We'll help you do
the whole
the
thing.
Whole
right. Thing. Solution. Say it again. Software.
We are a solution provider,
right.
which has a mix of software, hardware, and services.
Tell me where the telecommunication business is going to be 5 years from now, 10 years from now.
I think the telecommunications business will look back on this period as a period of robust and explosive innovation from 96 up through 2000 that got considerably ahead of itself, went through a digestion period, and then became again the most dynamic, the most interesting, the most innovative, and probably the fastest growing of all the commercial sectors.
Mm-hmm.
Not at the 30, 40, 50% that we grew at, some grew at.
Cisco and others, yeah.
Yeah. But I think the market itself is likely to be robust, interesting, and full of new energy and ideas.
Okay, but tell me what it means in terms of people, the way they go about living their life and doing their business.
Well, we will eventually have broadband capacity to the home, and we'll have very broad, but not as broad, a band capacity to your handheld devices. That technology is available now. It will become smaller. It will become cheaper. It will become lighter, easier to use, and we will be able to be in communication with each other everywhere, anytime we care to, whether it be at our home, in our office, walking down the street. It'll be our choice of how we care to communicate with each other and with stationary items that have our memory banks, et cetera, et cetera. The brave new world we talked about communications, is going to be there.
But is it going to be there later than we thought?
Yes, of course. It always is. Always is.
We
always
get ahead of ourselves. All we do. We get ahead of ourselves in terms of...
We think about ideas, and then we say, oh, well, that isn't going to work. Then there's a period of pause, and all of a sudden...
Everything's going to work.
There we are. It's there. And that's the way technology works. It bursts upon the scene. We often overestimate its immediate impact. We have a chance to absorb and understand it. We bring its costs down so it's available to many more people. All of a sudden, we have ubiquitous capacity. New people think of new ideas. Who would have heard of PDAs, you know, 10 years ago? Now everybody's got them in their pocket.
Exactly,
you know. And that's going to continue. And these, we will go through miniaturization. We'll get to voice recognition. I believe keyboards will eventually disappear.
Because of voice recognition?
Because voice recognition will be easy.
When do you think that's going to happen?
I really don't know.
But do you think it's within the next 10 years?
Yes, absolutely. But not in the next 3 to 4.
It'll be all voice recognition within 10 years.
Not all, because it's going to be...
75%.
Yeah, but it will slowly take over, and the more simple tasks we'll learn about miniaturization of the computer size of the chipset in order to do the complicated algorithms required. And it will begin to take it over. Well, you can do it now. You can do it in the lab now. I can sit in Bell Labs and say, call my wife.
And a phone call is made.
You say the same thing and the phone call isn't made.
It knows the difference.
Now, that's not yet commercial. But the gee whiz bank stuff, we don't see Buck Rogers in the comic strips that dates me. But we see it, well, we see it in Bell Labs every day.
So those people who say, look, you know, but things are not going to turn around until broadband takes root, are right.
Right.
And broadband will take root in the next...
I don't think... It depends upon what people mean by takeoff. We have the last mile bottleneck to the home.
Right.
We don't know how to economically get from the curb to the home.
Just for the sake... Explain that to people, what you mean by that.
Broadband means, in my terms, a big pipe that we can put all sorts of information down that little pipes can't handle. This is the so-called cable to the curb. We now are replacing older technology with newer technology. We are replacing copper with cable, with optical cable. An optical cable carries light waves, and it can do all sorts of interesting things, and it can do it in very small spaces. And we've got that capacity to provide a big pipe
from here to here.
From here, we've got it in the backbone, we've got it in transport, we've got it increasingly in the business community to the desktop.
Right.
You've got it out here.
Right, exactly.
You got it out here, as you should. Right. And so the commercial world is there because they can provide it, because video on demand and two-way video they use every day. The big next two places where we need broadband is, one, to the home, and we know how to do it technically. And Bell Labs has done it over and over again, but we haven't got the price point down yet to where the consumer is willing to pay what it requires to get there. Nor do we have what's called a killer application. Everybody says it's video on demand, or two-way video.
No.
Not sure yet.
So if it's not
too expensive. Too expensive for what people aren't willing to pay for it yet, but the price points are dropping. Our prices drop every year.
But in a sense, that's also interactivity.
That's right. You and I could talk and say, this is a picture phone, finally, and those kind of things. But then we need broadband to whatever the consumer, you and I, and everybody walking around this town and others, in a handheld device. And right now, we are in the crude first stage of that. We've moved from analog to digital. Now we're getting increased capacity, second generation, third generation, in the handheld device. And that will eventually be cheap enough, so we will be able to get whatever we want on our screens. Screens will be small. The batteries will come down. It'll become a much more convenient device than it is right now. And those two things are what are going to drive, in my view, growth. Now, are we going to see growth at this level? I don't think so. Nor do I think we should count on it. We are a maturing industry as opposed to an explosive early growth industry. There will always be segments of our industry that grow very, very fast. the new idea that doesn't come from Lucent or our competitors, but comes from the small shops, West Coast, East Coast, South, North, overseas, Israel, other places like that. There'll always be those, but there's not going to be a lot of people in between. It's going to be small startups and a few of these very large service providers and a few very large vendor partners like ourselves, and nobody in between. But the innovation machine is going to work with larger companies, therefore growth of 30-40% against 25-30 is tough. But 10-12 is very much...
Okay, but let me just come back to one point you made.
Sure.
20 to what's available?
I think 10-12% in this market.
John Chambers thinks Cisco is going to be back at 30-50% growth. You,
I wouldn't quarrel with John in the world.
Okay.
I'm talking about Lucent.
I know, but and he's talking about I'm not sure when in the future.
That's right. He's also talking about his company. He's not talking about the industry.
That's right, exactly. There are those, as you know, who want to write the obituary of Lucent. And you say?
They're wrong. They're wrong by a large,
you're a dead body.
By a large margin. I do not intend to have a dead body prematurely. But there's three issues here. Do you have a plan which, if implemented, will make Lucent profitable next year and give it a chance to be at benchmark earnings the following year? And the answer is, we have that plan now. Secondly, do you have enough liquidity in order to carry that plan out with enough margin that allows for the fact this is a very tough market? And with the sale of fiber and the successful convertible preferred week before last, we have twice what we need, even on a conservative plan. And the third is, can you execute
cash on hand?
Yeah, cash on hand, or contracted,
most of it
from reputable people to be delivered in the next 35 to 40 days.
Right.
So we've got a plan that we are convinced is executable, and we've been out and seeing our customers, and I believe they believe that. We have liquidity, twice what we need to execute that plan, and we're now talking about execution. That's betting on ourselves. So we had three challenges to get behind us. We've now gotten two behind us. That means most of the work is still in front of us because that's execution. But we're now betting on ourselves, and I believe that's a good bet.
Yeah. Talk about, finally, this notion of how important confidence is.
Oh, yeah.
You know, to say what you just said, you got to convince people on Wall Street, you got to convince your customers, because if they don't think you're going to be around, they don't want to be buying from you.
It's absolutely true.
Because you're not going to deliver.
That's right. I spent a lot of time talking with the constituents required for us to be successful. But within the set of confines that, in retrospect, we did an awful lot of talking in 99 and 2000, and we didn't do a lot of delivering. That means that people aren't really going to be convinced till we deliver. And I believe that we should be talking less and performing more. And we've been following that in the last 8-9 months since I've been back. And I think we're now beginning to catch people's attention that, hey, these guys really do what they say they're going to do. The seven-point plan we executed flawlessly on. We beat every one of the targets and ahead of time. It just, in retrospect, wasn't enough. We have phase two in. The credibility of phase one will carry us through in our external community. We did it when we said we'll do this too. We can now say to people, we have a plan, here it is, we have the financing, it's in the bank, not we're going to get it one day, and now it's an execution. And this is the largest telecommunication vendor partner in the world, still. And it will survive and grow and prosper. And that message is, with our customers, welcome news. Because, after all, most of these networks are the networks we built in the original incarnation. So we know it better than anyone else. And we'll have stiff competition, but that's healthy. But the issue of dealing with confidence in your constituents, the two most important constituents are, without any ranking, your customers and your employees. If you have your customers and your employees aligned around what we've just described,
if they are believers,
the money will come. And the results will follow. I think Wall Street is to be respected and to be treated as a important constituent. But for us, they will only pay attention to results, and I don't blame them.
So
this is not a time for talk. This is a time for performance. So for what do we need for performance?
Yeah.
We need the confidence of our customers, and we need the confidence of our employees. And I believe we have both.
Finally, what's the next sort of What's the next event day or target day that people who want to test your...
They should follow our day-to-day performance in ways that are available to them. The first and most unpleasant and most difficult event we've already talked about, and that is as soon as we're finished with our discussions with the banks, which are going very well, which should be done in the next 5 to 10 days now, we will embark on reducing our workforce 15 to 20 as thoughtfully and fairly and humanely as we possibly can. That puts us in a position, hopefully by the 1st of September, to say to the 55 to 60,000 people that are remaining, we are the core of Lucent going forward. It's a period to pause and reflect and to thank those who are no longer with us for the contribution they made, but it's also a time to look forward and to execute on this plan and to be with our customers every day so that they know about the execution. You'll be able to track that externally. We will report, we have said, sequentially better earnings this quarter, but the really critical quarter is the fourth calendar quarter this year, which will be our first performing quarter under the new incarnation. So looking at our results in the final calendar quarter of this year and the first calendar quarter of next year is what will tell the story. And I believe it's a good story. And when you have we have a good market, and you have premier customers who, although are spending less, are still spending a lot, and you have first-rate human talent and technology, it's a winner, and that's what we're out to show.
Thank you for coming.
Charlie, thanks for having me.
Great to have you.
Thank you again.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Henry Schacht of Lucent Technologies. Stay with us. Historian Stephen Ambrose's books on World War II bring to life the courage and valor of ordinary men faced with the extraordinary task of combat. They include Citizen Soldiers, D-Day, and Band of Brothers, which will premiere as an HBO miniseries on September 9th. His newest book, The Wild Blue, tells the story of the young soldiers who flew the B-24 Liberator bombers over Germany. At the center of the story is a 22-year-old George McGovern, who flew 35 combat missions and won the Distinguished Flying Cross. I'm pleased to have Stephen Ambrose back at this table again.
Thank you. Thank you.
I want to begin with this question for you. You are certainly the preeminent historian now about certainly World War II. It happened in a very interesting way. A phone call from Eisenhower gets you involved in working with him, which leads from the Civil War to this war. Knowing as much as you do, because Band of Brothers is going to be on coming up soon, you were a consultant to Private Ryan. If you had to serve in World War II and wanted to serve, as I'm sure you would have, where would you have wanted to be? With what? With the pilots?
No,
with the soldiers?
That was way too dangerous with the pilots.
With the men of the Navy?
It was all dangerous.
But where would you like to be? What would have the most appeal to you?
Easy Company, 506 Parachute Infantry Regiment, 101st Airborne, because the commander of that company, Dick Winters, was almost a Meriwether Lewis. He was so good. And if Dick told me then, or tells me now, to do something, I don't say, wait, don't you think, or, we should. I just do it.
He has what?
Character, of course, honesty, and a firmness of purpose and a direction to him. Mm-hmm. And he knows so much. He knows all of the weapons. He knows the men. He knows who can do what. He knows how to station them and how to lead an attack, and et cetera. He knows what a good company commander needs to know.
So you don't have a preference. You have a preference for a man.
Yes.
You know, rather than, it's not that you wanted to be a paratrooper.
No.
It's not that you wanted to be a rifleman. You wanted to be with him.
I wanted to be under Dick Winters. That's right. Absolutely.
Yeah, but you must be able to name 10 guys like that, or 100 guys, or
Not like him. I mean, Joe Dawson was another one who was just awfully, awfully good. And there were many others, Carwood Lipton and so on.
Right.
But Winters stands out above all of them. Yeah. And being in a bomber, the problem is I'd like George McGovern to be the pilot.
Why George McGovern? Oh. No, he's the center of this book.
because he was so outstanding.
Yeah.
He won a DFC, and he flew 35 missions, and everybody in the crew looked up to him. I interviewed all those guys. George always brought us back. The problem with being a tail gunner or a ball turret gunner or a radio man, first of all, you're so cramped in that B-24, and there's no room to do anything, and there's no hot coffee, there's no hot anything, there's no food. And if that plane gets hit and the engines go out and it goes down, you're gone.
It's over.
It's not the case in a rifle squad. Sometimes a whole squad can be wiped out, but that's very, very seldom. One or two guys get killed, one or two wounded. But when a plane goes down, whomp.
Who took the highest percentage of casualties in World War II, the Marines?
No, the Army Air Force's pilots.
They did.
Took the highest percentage of casualties.
50%?
50%.
Yeah. So one out of every two didn't come back.
That's right. And I remember they had a lot of time to themselves. I mean, you were stuck on a base and it's raining and you're not going to fly that day. And sometimes that could go on for a week and even more. But once you enter that flak area, your chances of getting out, over Ploesti, for example, one quarter of the bombers were blown out of the sky and another quarter of the bombers were badly damaged and another quarter were hit. So, and that's also true in the Navy. I mean, if the ship gets hit and it's going down, you're going down with it. Almost, period. That's it. So you had a little bit of a better chance in the infantry, but whether Marines or Army.
Food was better in the Navy.
Food was way better in the Navy, yes. Food was also pretty good for the airmen.
Yeah, it sure was.
And they had cots to sleep on, and that beat the hell out of sleeping in a foxhole. But when those planes got hit,
but you get up in the morning, you still write, what, 8-9 hours a day?
Yes.
Don't you?
When I'm writing,
yeah. Yeah, well, you're writing all the time.
No, I'm not. Half the time I'm researching.
Okay. But, I mean, how long does that take a day?
Just a long time.
Yeah, sure.
You spend a lot of time.
You're already working on a new book about the Pacific.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And what happens after the Pacific? When are we going to cover this war?
After the Pacific, I ain't going to study war no more.
Are you serious?
That'll be enough.
Are you serious?
Sure.
I don't think so.
No, I want to work on something. I want to work on the environment.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Boy, you have been tough on some of the presidential candidates on the environment. Have you basically said to them, either you've got to understand the environment is crucial, and I'll go testify in Congress against you if you don't make the right decisions.
Yeah, that's right. I just was with Vice President Cheney and telling
you. Gave him a piece of your mind about Alaska?
I did. And a lot of things. But I said, you know, the president who led us into the 20th century was Teddy Roosevelt. And he said, conservation is the most important issue in this country. And he passed the Antiquities Act. And he created Grand Canyon National Park. And he did it because they had discovered coal at the bottom of the Grand Canyon, and of course people wanted to go in and get that coal out of there, and he made it into a national park because he said you can't improve it.
Right.
Now, he's most remembered for his conservation. All the other things that Teddy Roosevelt did are there, of course, but it's conservation and people. And so I told Cheney, now you guys, this administration, are leading us into the 21st century, and if you want to be remembered, you've got to urge and promote and support conservation. That snapped his head back a little bit.
What do you mean snapped his head back?
Well, he hadn't thought of it that way.
Well, do you think he got the message?
I hope.
Yeah, but I mean,
if he didn't, I'll be back.
But you know, there it seems to me that their attitude about the environment, and they'd be best to define this, certainly in terms of oil and gas, is to produce more, to produce more, to produce more.
Yeah.
It is a supply side rather than a demand side theory of environmental action.
Yes, that's right. But that's not my attitude. And my attitude is, when we want electricity in the future, and we will, of course,
right,
we're going to get it from the three most basic sources that can never be depleted: the sun, the wind, and the tides. And that's how we're going to generate electricity. We're not going to be using fossil fuels. We're not going to be using fossil fuels.
Yeah. What about nuclear? They don't have any problem with nuclear in Europe.
I'm and not so opposed to nuclear as I am to new drills and new wells and so on.
Right. Let me come back to war. Do you you still have the same enthusiasm for this? I mean, you know, after having done what you have done.
Sure I do. Of course I do. Listen, I was 10 years old when the war ended.
Right.
I always looked on those guys as giants, my father among them.
Right.
And they were. And I still feel that way. I'm a hero worshiper. And these guys were our heroes. And they saved Western civilization.
So, boy, somebody did something great for you when they got you directed towards this kind of a historical work. Because
Dwight Eisenhower.
And you said.
Yeah.
He introduced you, he gave you a means to go out and do your research. Because you had the imprimatur of the commander.
Yeah, that helped a lot.
Yeah.
A lot.
Who is your favorite general that was not an American?
Erwin Rommel.
Really was. The Desert Fox.
Rommel said at one point during the war, I'm so sick and tired of destruction. When this war is over, I want to build. Well, he didn't live through the war. And that's another story. But his son, Manfred Rommel, became mayor of Stuttgart. Manfred had been in the German army in the Second World War. He became mayor of Stuttgart. You go into Stuttgart and you're going to see, all they do is build. And he's doing what his father wanted to have happen. And he was a great general, but I've always admired him for that. I want to build.
I forgot who it was, but I met somebody who you would know who's famous in America who wanted to go back to Germany and went and met some of Rommel's folks. Because he admired Rommel, not anything about Nazis, but admired Rommel as a general.
Do you know who are very close friends? David Montgomery, the field marshal's only son, and Manfred Rommel, Erwin Rommel's only son.
Good friends.
Very close. Yeah, very much. And John Eisenhower is a part of that. John isn't quite so close to those guys as they are to each other, but John knows them and gets along with them well.
He's a historian too, isn't he?
Yes.
And he's writing books?
That's right.
He writes recent books.
Okay.
Yeah. I didn't realize until very recently that Ulysses S. Grant wrote a very good memoir.
Many of us, and I'm one, think the best ever by any American soldier. And it stands a comparison with Caesar's commentaries.
Is that right?
Yes, absolutely.
Because he let it all, put it all on page, with passion.
He never wrote about his presidency.
Yeah,
and that was probably a good thing.
Because all the cronies were corrupt.
And that was probably a good thing. But his account of his life up to the Civil War, and then his Civil War, was just outstanding.
Was he a better general than Sherman?
Yes.
He was.
Yeah, he was better than anybody.
Better than anybody.
Oh.
It wasn't just he wrote good books. He was a good general.
Oh. Very much. He won the war.
When nobody else.
He defeated Robert E. Lee.
Yeah, of course.
Nobody else had ever done that.
But help me understand about Robert E. Lee, because there seems to be some revisionism about him. Maybe he wasn't as good as we thought.
Oh, he was even better than we think.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So Gettysburg was not a mistake?
Gettysburg was a mistake.
Okay.
One of the things that I admire about Robert E. Lee is that at Appomattox, some of his staff told him, scatter these guys up in the hills and we can carry on in guerrilla warfare. And Lee said, that would be terrible.
Yeah.
That would be the worst thing that we could possibly do. We're going to surrender everybody. We're not going to send anybody in the hills to do guerrilla warfare.
Let me come back to this book, because this is what is the focus of attention now in terms of readers and in terms of what your work product. These were very young men, weren't they?
George McGovern, at age 21, was the pilot. The flight engineer, his name was Velko, was 23. Everybody else in that plane was a teenager.
Yeah.
All of them.
This reminds me, I'm going back, I'm skipping around now. This reminds me of the story about you and Spielberg, in which Spielberg asked you to look at Sergeant Ryan and say, listen, are any mistakes? Did you see anything, he said to you? And you said, yeah, Hanks is too old to be a Ranger.
Yeah, I said, you got to get Hanks out of there. He said, you're funny.
Yeah, not funny at all. But back to these guys. They all were. What were their physical qualifications? I mean, did you, because...
Well, you had to have the eyesight, the eye-hand
coordination
responses, knowledge, and ability to learn quickly, ability to make decisions and stick to them were all part of their physical qualities, absolutely. Some of them were athletes, many were, but many had never been athletes. You know, this B-24, a squadron leader in the 8th Air Force was Jimmy Stewart. And he is reputed to have been one of the best squadron commanders ever.
Ever?
Ever. I get that from guys that I've interviewed who flew with Stewart. So, and McGovern was not an athlete, but he was an awfully good pilot.
Because he had good eyes and good hand-eye coordination.
Many of the pilots had been athletes.
Ted Williams was a good pilot.
Ted Williams, one of the very best.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. No. So he had eyes like nobody else did.
But Jimmy Stewart was a great pilot. How many of them were captured?
Well, an awful lot were shot down.
Did they bail out, some of them?
The ones that survived bailed out. If the plane went down and you were in it, you were dead.
Right.
But those who were able to jump out and parachute down, if they were in bad luck, German farmers would get them with a pitchfork.
Is that right?
Oh, they hated those pilots. The German army had patrols out. They wanted those pilots or the crew. They wanted them alive. They wanted to interrogate them. So there were a lot of them that became POWs, certainly.
Yeah. Why haven't you written about the resistance?
It was a big war, Charlie. There are a lot of things that I haven't written about.
It's still magical, though, for you.
Oh, very much.
The war.
Very much.
Yeah.
And learning all the time. How did these guys do it? That's what I wanted to know.
You know what
I found out.
What amazes me, too, is how cold it got in those planes. Because of the elevation.
50 below.
And what did they do?
Well, they had an electric hookup on their suit with the electricity coming from the engines. Then they had on big sheepskin jackets and great big gloves, and they had an oxygen mask because above 10,000 feet, they had to have it. And they had fur-lined boots, and they froze. That's what they did. They just froze. The waist gunners, those windows were always open. With the machine gun sticking out, you can imagine 50 below what the wind is like up there.
Yeah, and you'll cover the men and women, I mean the men who flew in the Pacific during the whole book on the Pacific, yes?
Yes.
Okay, that'll be the Army and the Navy and everybody else, the Marines especially. Yeah. Iwo Jima was the worst casualties ever on a battle for the United States in terms of percentages or not?
Yes, it was, yeah. First of all, for the Marines and then for the U.S. as a whole, that's right. Yeah, it was. And it was the only time which the Japanese actually killed more Marines. There were 20,000 Japanese on that island.
Yeah.
They all
perished.
They took out more Marines than their own.
You remember how many?
About 22,000.
Wow.
Yeah. Out of 70,000.
Two things we should say. One is that you want people to write you. If they have a story, if they have a diary, if they have any kind of information.
Anybody who was in the Pacific, that's right.
In the Pacific. Where did it write?
900 University, Helena, Montana, 59601.
You'll find him there at his little desk working into the night. No, you get up early in the morning. You're a 4 o'clock in the morning guy, aren't you?
Yeah.
You know, and work throughout the day. Yeah. But it's just the story of, I mean, it's one great story after another.
Oh, it is.
Tragic, poignant, heroic.
Some humor.
Humor.
Heroic.
Stephen Ambrose.
You just cry a lot of times. A lot of times.
Oh. Your wife walks in there and brings you a cup of coffee and you're crying.
Yeah.
Stephen Ambrose, the Wild Blue, the men and boys who flew the B-24s over Germany. He has dedicated his life, both in terms of his writings and through his commitment to the museum down in New Orleans, to remembering what Tom Brokaw calls the best generation. I am pleased to have him, as always, on this program. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Stay with us.
The West leads by 3. Marbury for 3. Yes! And he's tied the game.
Stephon Marbury is one of the top point guards and most dynamic players in the NBA today.
Here comes Stephon. And Marbury takes it all the way through.
Go. The first delivery with a left hand. Knocked it ahead from Marbury. Splitting the defense with a left. Marbury for 3. Yes! And he's tied the game. The West by 2. Marbury for 3. Again! Stephon Marbury has given the East a 1-point lead. 25 seconds to go.
It's amazing what he can do to you, man.
Last season, Marbury was the only player to rank in the top 10 in both assists and in points. He's been a leader on the basketball court for nearly his entire life. In high school, the Brooklyn-born NBA All-Star was one of the most highly sought-after athletes in the country. In 1996, he was the 4th pick overall in the pro draft. Today, he enters his 6th season in the league and his first with the Phoenix Sun. This weekend, his charitable work will be marked by the first Starberry Fantasy Weekend here in New York, and I am pleased to have him back at this table. He was last here when, five years ago.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me.
Great to see you.
You were in high school then.
High school.
With your father, who came here to talk about the career that you were about to have, and in fact, you have had. There's so much to talk about in terms of basketball wrapping up this season. Mm-hmm. You like this trade?
I love it. I'm delighted. I'm elated. I'm so happy about the trade. Because, one, I feel like God puts everyone in place where he wants them to be, and also, I feel like this is the closest that I'm going to be as far as to win an NBA championship.
Is that right? You think they can do it? The Suns can do it?
I think we definitely can.
Okay, how are you going to build this team down there?
Well, one, we have Sean Marion.
Yeah.
Penny Hardaway is healthy.
Right.
We have Tom Gugliotta.
Right, he's good.
We have Rodney Rogers.
Yeah.
We have Tony Del, Vinny Del Negro.
Yeah.
Dan Marley. Jake Sakalidis, our young big man, he's definitely coming along. We drafted a high school kid, you know, so we're getting younger, we're getting bigger, we're getting faster, and we're getting stronger.
Did you want the trade? Did you ask for the trade?
I didn't ask for the trade. It just happened. You know, it just happened. I just felt like, you know, Rod Thorn felt that he wanted to go elsewhere. And, you know, sometimes change is good.
Did he come to you and say, I'm thinking about this, or did they just tell you after the move done?
He never said anything. We had a meeting, and he told me that he never spoke to anyone about me being traded, and that if he was to trade me, that I would be the first person to know. And he kept his word. He told me that.
You were the first person to know.
Yep.
Yeah. Did you want to play for the Knicks?
Did I want to play for the Knicks?
Yeah,
I mean, that's a childhood dream.
I know.
Of course you want to play for the Knicks.
Well, you grew up in New York as a childhood.
From New York. So, you know, that's definitely been my childhood.
Why didn't it ever happen?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, the obvious answer is salary cap, but other than that.
I don't know.
Did you try to make it happen? Did you?
I mean, when
as much as you can without getting in trouble with the league.
When I was coming out of Minnesota, you know, that was definitely the first priority. You know, always to try to become a Knick. But I knew that Minnesota would never trade me to the Knicks. So
why would they ever trade you to the Knicks?
The Minnesota?
Yeah.
Because they felt like they would have been helping me.
Oh, they didn't want to help you.
I mean,
there was bad blood there.
No,
in Minnesota.
I'm just saying, like, I didn't have any bad blood. You know, it was just drawn out to be that way, but.
Yeah, but that was, you were anxious to get out of there. I know it's in the past.
I wanted to leave. I mean, I wanted to be closer to home. And, you know, I'm here to say, and I can honestly say that I'd rather win than be close to home.
Yeah.
You know, and for me to say that, I think it takes a lot for myself to say that.
Tell me what you would do differently since you've been in the pros.
What would I have done differently? I think I'm a big believer. I'm a big believer that everything happens for a reason. And you learn through trial and error.
Okay, tell me the trial and errors that you think were most instructive.
The most instructive? Leaving Minnesota was one of them. Leaving Minnesota was, I wouldn't say it was a mistake. It was just, like my sister would say, haste before waste. I really didn't think about it before, you know, I was talking about me wanting to be back home. Because, you know, they say, be careful what you ask for. You know, and I go from winning to losing. And that's a big jump.
All right, take a look at this. This is you on my show in 1994. This is 1994. There you are.
God.
17 years old with your father, Don, and coach Bobby Hartston.
Oh, my God.
Roll tape. When did you become a player? When did you?
When I was about two, three. when I was younger, I used to go to my brother's game at Georgia, my oldest brother.
Yeah.
And I always wanted to get the ball and shoot and run around the court.
You've grown. You're what, 6'2" now?
Yeah.
Yeah. And how much longer more will you grow? Do you think? Is there any sense?
I hope I grow to be 6'9".
You'd like to be 6'9", would you?
Oh, love you.
What does he bring? What is it about this young player that has made him the talk of New York, and on a familiarity basis with every coach in America?
I like to say he's the total package.
Yeah.
Every phase of the game, he excels at. He plays both ends of the court. He shoots the ball extremely well. He's a great passer, handles the ball. Really everything you would want in a point guard. And his personality and his leadership also come into play.
Look at my father. He's so cool.
Your father.
My father's
you
so
want
cool.
this tape, though, don't
oh,
you?
Oh, yeah, I got to have that. I got to have that.
Then I'll be sitting courtside at all the Phoenix Suns games. You didn't grow to be 6'9", though, did you?
No.
What are you now, 6'4"?
6'2".
What do you need to do to make your game better? What is it you need to do to get...
I just have to keep learning the game. I have to learn all the facets of the game. I have to continue to grow. I have to continue to want to learn and listen.
You got enough skills? I mean, can you stop and go?
Oh, stop and go all day. Stop and go 33, baby. Always.
Stop and go is my name.
That's it. Stop, go.
Go. Stop, go.
That's how you jerk them, you know what I'm saying? You bring them here and then you take them over here.
Yeah. I mean, don't you see some new moves out there that you saw some of these guys do that you think, man, but by the time the new season rolls around, it'll be in my repertoire. It'll be in my bag.
The Rolodex, it's so much stuff in the Rolodex that, you know, sometimes you trick yourself.
Yeah.
You know, you be on the court, you trick yourself sometimes.
Who beats you consistently?
Who beat me consistently?
Yeah, in other words, who do you have a hard time with if they're guarding?
In the NBA?
Yeah. Well, yes, of course.
Nobody.
No, oh, come on.
Nobody.
What was
the person that did? My first year.
I'm not talking about your who?
Gary Payton.
Payton.
My toughest competitor.
Really? Because what? He got inside your head or because of what?
No, because my rookie year, the way how they played, it allowed them to do so many different things defensively. And it used to just annoy me how I could never get off pick and roll. I could never get my shot off. But I said to myself, and I wasn't strong enough. That's another thing that hurt me my rookie year. I wasn't strong enough. I wasn't physically ready to, like, bang the way how I wanted to bang. I could hold my own, but I couldn't do what I wanted to do. Like, now when I play a game, physical strength has nothing to do with how I play. You know, if I go out on the court and I don't have a good game, it's not because I can't guard a person. It's because that person played better than me that night.
And it happens.
It happens.
And why does it happen?
Why does it happen? Because some nights it's just
you
like
just don't have it.
Some nights you just don't have it.
The ball doesn't go
the
in.
Next night, you know, that's the most important. Night,
next
how
night,
you rebound.
The basket looks as big as this table.
Exactly. That's when you rebound. And it seems like when you don't play well, when you're out there on the court that night, it sinks on you that night, you know, when you're sleeping, like, man, I'm going to go to practice, and you come ready. You come into practice ready, and then the next game, you dominate.
How good is this kid that they drafted at the Wizards, number one? The number one NBA draft is a high school player.
I know, it's crazy.
It's crazy?
Sebastian Telfair might be the first.
What's the word? What's the word? You think next year may be a junior?
Maybe.
What's the word on Sebastian? What's his name?
Sebastian Telfair.
What's the word on him?
What's the word on him?
Yeah.
What?
How good is he?
He's better than what I was.
Well, of course he is. But
exactly. That's how I feel. Just like what you said. That's how I feel. Of course. They ask me, of course. That's how good he is.
He's that good. Because some guys have played against him up in Massachusetts this summer.
Good.
They said he's good.
It's unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
He won't start, though.
Start where? In NBA? No, he won't probably start, but he'll be a player that won't start in the middle of the season.
Is that right?
Yeah. In the middle of the season, he'll start, because once he learns the game, it's over.
Now, what does he have to learn?
He has to learn the NBA game. See, it's different levels to this thing here we call basketball. You got high school, you got college, and you got the NBA. And then in the NBA, we got preseason, then we got regular season, then we got the playoffs, then we got the championship.
So some of that you haven't seen yet.
Right, exactly. I've seen the playoffs, but I haven't seen championship.
Right.
And that's why I'm here today to talk to you and tell you about that, and also to talk to you about my event.
All right, tell me about your event before we go.
Okay, August 18th and the 19th, I have Starberry Fantasy Weekend.
Right.
The 18th is called Star Night, and, you know, we're looking for people to come star-studded.
Right.
Wilhelmina and Hugo Boss, we're going to have, you know, them guys having a fashion show, and then it's going to be a party. And then Sunday we have Starberry Playland, which you know, we're allowing every kid in America to come and participate. You know, we're going to have Allen Iverson there, Tracy McGrady.
There's another big star. Yeah.
Yes, he's very good. Sharif Abdul-Rahim, Al Harrington, Steve Francis, Katino Mobley, John Wallace. You know, I'm going to have all them guys come, and they're going to be there, you know, watching the kids, showing them what to do as far as certain moves, and, you know, going over things that they've done to get where they at. And, you know, people want to come, and if they're interested, they can log on to my website, www.stephonmarbury.net, or they can call 750-7926-201 area code.
All right. That's in New Jersey.
Yes, in New Jersey.
Good for you, my
Thank
friend.
You so
Great
much.
To see you. Best to your family.
Thank you.
And the Phoenix Suns will be happy to have you there, and you'll have a new home, and we'll see what happens.
Thank you for having me.
Great to have you. Stephon Marbury, thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Lexus is a proud corporate sponsor of public television.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.